So, as you can see from the screen, the rules of our webinar are, webinar will be start at 9:10 a.m. and then participants should use the format name as listed institution underscores name. And if you want to change your name, you may enter the room Zoom and then click top right corner in the participant list and then click more and then click rename and fill in format institution underscores name, for example, BRIN underscores alpha to facilitate during attendance and discussion. Next, participants may ask the question through Q&A feature or directly by raise hand. And don't forget to mention the name and institution, also the purpose of the question or by fill in the comment column through live streaming YouTube of BRIN Indonesia. Next, presentation materials will be available at the end of the presentation and a certificate will be delivered to the participants who fill the attendance form and IKM questionnaire. And the last, the attendance form and questionnaire will be set at the end of the presentation. Thank you.
National Research and Innovation Agency, a synergy in an orchestra. Established through the Presidential Regulation No. 78 of 2021 about the National Research and Innovation Agency. To enhance science and technology's contribution to the national development and to improve the research and innovation ecosystem in Indonesia. The National Research and Innovation Agency is a government agency that is directly responsible to the President of the Republic of Indonesia. Consists of 7 deputies, supported by 12 research institutes, have 85 research centers, Executive Secretariat, Executive Inspectorate, Center for Data and Information, Center for Technology Services, and Polytechnic Institute of Nuclear Technology Indonesia. Through the three directions, science and technology resources mobilization, providing a favorable research ecosystem, building an economy foundations based on research. The presence of National Research and Innovation Agency is to achieve Indonesia's goals as a developed country in 2045. Also to make Indonesia as a global reference for sciences, bringing advantages on science and technology development, policy making, and societies. National Research and Innovation Agency, a synergy in an orchestra. Established through the Presidential Regulation No. 78 of 2021 about the National Research and Innovation Agency. To enhance science and technology's contribution to the national development and to improve the research and innovation ecosystem in Indonesia. The National Research and Innovation Agency is a government agency that is directly responsible to the President of the Republic of Indonesia. Consists of 7 deputies, supported by 12 research institutes, have 85 research centers, Executive Secretariat, Executive Inspectorate, Center for Data and Information, Center for Technology Services, and Polytechnic Institute of Nuclear Technology Indonesia. Through the three directions, science and technology resources mobilization, providing a favorable research ecosystem, building an economy foundations based on research. The presence of National Research and Innovation Agency is to achieve Indonesia's goals as a developed country in 2045. Also to make Indonesia as a global reference for sciences, bringing advantages on science and technology development, policy making, and societies. National Research and Innovation Agency, a synergy in an orchestra. Established through the Presidential Regulation No. 78 of 2021 about the National Research and Innovation Agency. To enhance science and technology's contribution to the national development and to improve the research and innovation ecosystem in Indonesia. The National Research and Innovation Agency is a government agency that is directly responsible to the President of the Republic of Indonesia. Consists of 7 deputies, supported by 12 research institutes, have 85 research centers, Executive Secretariat, Executive Inspectorate, Center for Data and Information, Center for Technology Services, and Polytechnic Institute of Nuclear Technology Indonesia. Through the three directions, science and technology resources mobilization, providing a favorable research ecosystem, building an economy foundations based on research. The presence of National Research and Innovation Agency is to achieve Indonesia's goals as a developed country in 2045. Also to make Indonesia as a global reference for sciences, bringing advantages on science and technology development, policy making, and societies. Thank you. National Research and Innovation Agency, a synergy in an orchestra. Established through the Presidential Regulation No. 78 of 2021 about the National Research and Innovation Agency. To enhance science and technology's contribution to the national development and to improve the research and innovation ecosystem in Indonesia. The National Research and Innovation Agency is a government agency that is directly responsible to the President of the Republic of Indonesia. Consists of 7 deputies, supported by 12 research institutes, have 85 research centers, Executive Secretariat, Executive Inspectorate, Center for Data and Information, Center for Technology Services, and Polytechnic Institute of Nuclear Technology Indonesia. Through the three directions, science and technology resources mobilization, providing a favorable research ecosystem, building an economy foundations based on research. The presence of National Research and Innovation Agency is to achieve Indonesia's goals as a developed country in 2045. Also to make Indonesia as a global reference for sciences, bringing advantages on science and technology development, policy making, and societies.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? We will initiate the program. Thank you. The respectable, the chairman of the Research Organization for Agriculture and Food, National Research and Innovation Agency, Dr. Puji Lestari. The Honorable, the Director of Research Center for Appropriate Technology, National Research and Innovation Agency, Dr. Ahmad Sarifuddin. Our invited speakers, Dr. Engineering Muhammad Tusef Asgar from the Department of Farm Machinery and Power, University of Agriculture, Pakistan. Dr. Engineering Insinyur Agung Wibowo, MT from the Faculty of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, Bandung Institute of Technology. Mr. Bambang Budiono ST from the PT Wafik Mitra Teknik, and Dr. Slamet Widodo from the Department of Mechanical and Biosystem Engineering, IPB University. We also want to welcome our moderator today, Dr. Muso Andrianto, representatives from our collaboration partners, ministries, institutions, and universities, and all distinguished participants. A very good morning from Subang, West Java, Indonesia. My name is Rutriana Melisa. It's my pleasure to be your master of ceremony in this international webinar entitled Precision Engineering in Agriculture Machineries today, Wednesday, September 20, 2023. In this occasion, we will try to bring up issues about precision engineering in agriculture sector, which can be related to appropriate technology development activities, especially in developing countries for sustainable living. Moreover, we also have to identify further potential bilateral or multilateral cooperation in research, technology, and innovation related to appropriate technology based on future trends of technology 4.0 in realizing precision engineering in the agricultural sector. This webinar is conducted virtually and live from Zoom webinar room and official YouTube channel of BRIN Indonesia. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, please be prepared for our first agenda, the National Anthem, Indonesia Raya.
Oh,
Thank you. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we will start this international webinar with a welcome remark from the Director of the Research Center for Appropriate Technology. Please welcome Dr. Ahmad Sarifuddin.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent and the most merciful, may peace, mercy and blessing of Allah be upon you. First of all, I would like to send my greeting to the Honorable Dr. Puji Lestari, our chairman, the head of research organizations and agriculture and food, National Research and Innovation Agency, Republic of Indonesia. The honorable speakers, Dr. Engineering Muhammad Tosif Asgar from the University of Agriculture, Pakistan, Dr. Engineer Insinyur Agung Wibrowo, MT from Bandung Institute of Technology, Indonesia, Mr. Bambang Budiono from PT Wafik Mitra Teknik Indonesia, Mr. Selamat Widodo, PhD from IPB University Indonesia, dear colleagues, professor, lecturers, researchers, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Research Center for Appropriate Technology, National Research and Innovation Agency, or PRTTG BRIN, I would like to express my sincere gratitude and also welcome to the international webinar with the team of Precision Engineering in Agriculture Machineries today, September 20, 2023. First of all, I would like to thank to all committee members who put their best efforts into making this webinar happen. Ladies and gentlemen, the topic of this online seminar or webinar is precision engineering in agriculture machineries. As we know that the Research Center for Appropriate Technology is the only research center under the Research Organization for Agriculture and Food that is responsible for the development of agriculture machinery. Implementations of precision engineering during the research and development stage of agriculture machinery is inevitable. Precision methods should be implemented during the designing, manufacturing, and testing stage. Precision concepts should also be adopted in the field of appropriate technology, including equipment or machinery and process engineering. We also included technology 4.0 as one of the tools to be complemented in precision engineering. Technology 4.0 has emerged as a promising technology framework used for integrating and extending manufacturing processes at both intra and inter-organizational levels. Therefore, appropriate technology must be able to adapt the concept of technology 4.0 on its development. Lastly, we expect through the implementations of precision engineering, our research center will gain higher standards in manufacturing, agriculture, and food processing machinery. Ladies and gentlemen, in this online webinar, we invite experts in the field of precision engineering, including Dr. Engineer Muhammad Tosif Asgar from the University of Agriculture, Pakistan. He will present the topic of drying process from engineering perspective. We also invite Dr. Engineer Agung Wibowo from ITB, Bandung Institute of Technology Indonesia, who will give a short lecture about precision engineering in manufacturing, food, and agriculture machineries. The next speaker is Mr. Bambang Budiono, from PT Wafik Mitra Teknik. He will talk technically about the process to support precision engineering. Lastly, we also invite Mr. Slamet Widodo, PhD, from Department of Mechanical and Biosystem Engineering, Faculty of Agricultural Engineering, IPB University, who will give a short lecture about control system for smart agriculture. Finally, I wish you a very productive online webinar with exciting and encouraging discussion and exchange of knowledge. May God bless us all with good health to make this event a successful and enjoyable one. Lastly, I sincerely request our principal, Dr. Puji Listari, to officially open this online conference. Thank you, and I give my time back to moderator. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Dr. Ahmad Sarifuddin, for your remarks. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, the next speech will be given by the chairman of the Research Organization for Agriculture and Food and officially open the webinar. Please welcome Dr. Puji Lestari.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. A very good morning, everyone. I am Puji Lestari, the Chairman of Research Organization for Agriculture and Food, National Research and Innovation Agency, Republic of Indonesia. First, I would like to thank and deliver my sincere gratitude to the honorable speakers, Dr. Muhammad Tusif Asghar from the University of Agriculture, Pakistan, Dr. Agung Wibowo MT from Bandung Institute of Technology Indonesia, Mr. Bambang Budiono from PT Wafik Mitra Teknik Indonesia, Slamet Widodo PhD from IPB University Indonesia, the head of the Research Center for Appropriate Technology and the Research Organization for Agriculture and Food, Dr. Ahmad Sarifuddin, all researchers, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, and all participants in this webinar. Let's begin to sing the grace to the Almighty God, our Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, as His will that we are gathered today in a good heart to take a part in this event and giving you all a warm welcome in the international webinar held by the Research Center for Appropriate Technology with the topic of Precision Engineering in Agriculture Machineries. Ladies and gentlemen, Technology 4.0 has emerged as a promising technology framework used for integrating and extending manufacturing processes at both intra- and inter-organizational levels. The emergence of Technology 4.0 has been fueled by the recent development in information and communication technology, ICT, and multidiscipline sciences. The development and the technological advances in era 4.0 will provide a viable array of solutions to the growing need for informatization in most living problems. Technology 4.0 dramatically increases the overall level of industrialization, information and manufacturing digitization to achieve greater efficiency, competency and competitiveness, especially in the development of appropriate technology. As we know, the development of Technology 4.0 is a challenge to realize sustainable agriculture. Various technologies have been developed to recognize agriculture that prioritizes environmental, social, and economical aspects. Technological development aims to increase agricultural production in order to fulfill the people requirement to agriculture and food. Precision engineering implementation through Technology 4.0 can be interpreted as an agricultural system that combines information and technology to identify, analyze, and manage all variability in the agricultural sectors to obtain optimal and sustainable benefits while maintaining and protecting the environment. The implementation of precision engineering has a positive impact on the agriculture and food sectors. The application of sensors and artificial intelligence can increase water use efficiency to achieve environmental sustainability in agriculture. Developing the Internet of Things, this so agricultural machinery provides added value in agriculture by assisting farmers in cultivating, harvesting, and addressing labor shortage. Ladies and gentlemen, by participating in this webinar, I believe we are in the right place and time. Together, let us explore the exchange and sharing of ideas and scaling up of good practices in the research and innovation of precision engineering in agricultural machineries. Therefore, by reciting Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, I declare the international webinar with the topic of precision engineering in agricultural machineries organized today, September 20, 2023, is officially open. Finally, I wish you all a most fruitful and enjoyable webinar. Thank you in advance. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Dr. Puji Lestari, for your great remarks. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, before continuing the agenda, we will have the documentation session. So may I kindly invite all of the panelists to open the video and please the host to take the picture. Okay, ladies and gentlemen. Just waiting all of the panelists to open the video, please.
Assalamualaikum. May I request to please allow the open the video?
Yes.
Because it's stopped by the host.
Yeah. The finalists, the panelists cannot open the video.
Okay, please, host. Okay, wait for Dr. Tosef.
Yes, cannot. Yes, no. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to open the video.
Okay, thank you. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, be ready on the count of three. One, two, three. Thank you. Okay, once again, please welcome Mr. Bambang Budiono. Okay. Welcome, Pak Bambang. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, be ready on the count of three. One, two, three. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, let's move to our main agenda. And let me inform you that today's webinar, we will have four invited speakers. So may I kindly invite our moderator today, Dr. Muso Andrianto. Before Dr. Muso Andrianto starts his session, let me introduce about our moderator first. Dr. Muso Andrianto is a researcher in the Research Center for Appropriate Technology, National Research and Innovation Agency, who specializes in mechanical engineering. He graduated his doctoral degree from the National Central University, Taiwan, Republic of China. And currently, he also involved as a reviewer in the Journal of Manufacturing Processes. So finally, Dr. Muso Andrianto, the time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Anna. Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Muso Andrianto. Today I'm going to be a moderator in this international webinar. This international webinar will discuss about the precision engineering in agriculture machineries. Today we will have about four speakers. The first speaker is Dr. Muhammad Tusef Ashar from University of Agriculture, Pakistan. And then the second speaker is Dr. Agung Wibowo from Badung Institute of Technology, Indonesia. And the third speaker is Mr. Bambang Budiono from the PT Wafik Mitra Teknik Indonesia. And the fourth speaker is Dr. Slamet Widodo from IPD University Indonesia. Okay, before we start our webinar, first I would like to introduce the rule of this webinar. The speaker will deliver the presentation first and then be followed by the question and answer session. Every speaker will have about 30 minutes to deliver the presentation, and then for the question and answer session we'll conduct about 20 minutes. For audience, you can put your question in a Q&A column, and next in the Q&A session I will read your question. Okay, for the first speaker, I would like to invite Dr. Muhammad Tusef Ashar. Hello, Dr. Muhammad Tusef, good morning.
Okay, thank you, good morning.
How are you doing?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, in the name of Allah, the most beneficent and merciful. Thanks, Dr. Musa.
And Dr. Muhammad, I'm sorry, before you deliver your presentation, let me introduce
open my presentation, please.
Hi. Hello, Dr. Muhammad.
Hello, I'm here.
Before you deliver your presentation, please let me introduce your profile briefly. Yeah, Dr. Muhammad Tusef Ashar is a lecturer in the Department of Farm Machinery and Power in University of Agriculture, Faisalabad, Pakistan. He got his PhD in 2022 in Food Process Engineering with GPA point is 4.0. And his dissertation title is about processing of coconut SAP into syrup and granular sugar using different evaporation technique for economical production. And he already published many papers, and one of his publications is a review of nutritional effects, production, availability, and future aspects of coconut palm sugars. Okay, Dr. Muhammad Tusef, 30 minutes, yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Musa. I request you to please open my slides. I have already submitted to the panel. Or me to open my slides.
You can open your slide from your computer. Or...
Okay, it's okay. It's no problem for me.
Okay.
So just one moment, let me share the slides. Okay, so allow me to share screen, sorry. I hope you can see my slides.
Yeah, we can see your slides.
So, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In the name of Allah, most beneficent and merciful. First of all, I would like to thank you, Dr. Musa, for inviting me over here. And I am very thankful to all of the panels, especially the chairperson, Dr. Ahmed, and other management team. And I would like to say Assalamu alaikum from Pakistan. And very good morning. So my topic is about the dehydration and engineering perspectives. So first of all, what is precision engineering? Precision engineering in agriculture refers to the application of advanced technology, data-driven process, and innovative machinery to optimize various aspects of farming operations. It involves the precise measurement, analysis, and management of agricultural process. and resources, including soil conditions, crop growth, irrigation, and harvesting. So next is about the key components of precision engineering of agricultural machinery. First of all is sensors and data collection devices. These data collection devices gather essential data on soil condition, weather, crop health, and machinery performance. They provide real-time information crucial for decision-making in agricultural farming. So the next one is GPS technology. Global positioning system enables precise mapping and navigation within agricultural fields. It allows for accurate tracking of machinery location and data collection points. And the next one is automated control systems, which is very important in this era. So automated control system integrates sensor data and GPS information to adjust machinery operations in real time. They enable precise and efficient farming practices. So what are the benefits of the precision agriculture? Increased crop yield by optimizing resource allocation and reducing crop stress. Precision agriculture can significantly boost crop yield, ensuring a more consistent and reliable food supply. The next one is reduced resource uses, which is a very big problem actually. When we want to get more out of the agriculture, usually some people put more resources. So at the end, when they just calculated all the things, they don't get that kind of benefit because they have lost huge amount on the utilization of resources. So the precise management of water, fertilizer, and pesticides minimizes waste, lowers cost, and reduces the environmental impact. So the reduced uses has very good impact on environment because nowadays the environment is much more important for us. So if we have saved the resources, definitely we'll get more profitability, enhanced yield, and reduced resource expenses translate into improved farm profitability and financial stability. Environmental sustainability. Precision agriculture also minimizes the environmental footprint of farming by decreasing the resource use, chemical runoff, and greenhouse gas emission. So the next is about something about Industry 4.0, how it is impacting our food and agriculture industry. So the Industry 4.0 refers as the fourth industrial revolution, represents a paradigm shift in manufacturing industry, leverages advanced technologies such as the Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, big data, and automation to create smart and connected factories. In agriculture, 4.0 principles are applied to create smart farms, where data-driven decision-making, precision agriculture, and automation optimize farming process. The benefits include increased productivity, reduced resource wastage, improved quality control, and enhanced sustainability. In the context of food and agriculture sector, Industry 4.0 has potential to transform the entire value chain from farm to fork. So that we can include or we can explore many things in using Industry 4.0 in the field of agriculture and food so that we can transform this basic need of the human. So, now moving toward my topic, that is drying and process engineering perspective. Drying or dehydration is a fundamental process used across the industries to remove water or moisture from the substances. That is very crucial. Later on, I'll discuss. By definition, dehydration refers to the separation of water or moisture from substances for specific purpose. Actually, here, the specific purpose is much more important. So the specific purpose allows us to know how much moisture we have to remove. We just go for a thick syrup or just for drying preservation or bone drying, powder making. So many, many things are directly related with dehydration. So dehydration can be the key unit operation in industry. Importance: dehydration is crucial in industries because it can enhance the product quality. We can enhance the quality. It has ability to extend the shelf life. That is very important because we need the food throughout the year, but we get some seasonal products which are just available during the season. So if we want to consume those products throughout the year, definitely we need to extend their shelf life. And dehydration is one of best operations to extend shelf life with minimal loss of nutrition. So when we reduce that water content, actually what we do, we reduce the volume. When we reduce the volume, what will the impact? That will impact on transportation cost. So if we have to move bigger amount or bigger volume from one location to another, so we have to cost, it will cost more. We have to pay more cost. While by reducing its volume, by removing moisture content, the cost will be lowered and ensure the process efficiency. So it will also impact the efficiency of the process. So here are some applications of the dehydration process. It is definitely used in agri and food processing. Dehydration is essential to preserve food, fruits, vegetables, and meats, reducing food waste and enhancing shelf life for throughout use during the year. So it has also applications in pharmaceutical industry that removes moisture to create stable drugs formulations with extended shelf life, ensures medicine efficiency and safety. Also have the applications in petrochemical industry, natural gas processing industry, and also in the water treatment industry. So now moving towards the types and equipment used in dehydration. So first one and the most used is hot air drying. And for that purpose, we use hot air oven. So it is dehydration method that involves using heated air to remove moisture from substance, typically a solid or liquid substances, widely used in agri and food processing industry. The next one is freeze drying. Freeze and the equipment used is freeze dryer. So the freeze drying and sublimating water under vacuum conditions. It is crucial in pharmaceutical and food industries to preserve integrity of sensitive drugs and food nutrients. Distillation is also very important separation method that differences in boiling point, widely used in petrochemical industry and refining and separating the components. Further is adsorption. That is very important, also involves adsorbents that trap water molecules, commonly applied in natural gas processing to prevent pipeline ruptures. The next one is membrane separation, utilizes semi-malleable membranes to selectively allow the water passage, essential in desalination of wastewater treatment. And the next one and the last is chemical methods. Utilizes chemical reactions to remove water as a byproduct found in various chemical and manufacturing processes such as production of alcohols. Next are the steps in dehydration. There are three major steps in dehydration process. So the first one is pretreatment that may involve filtration, heating, or other preparatory steps to optimize the dehydration process. The next one is dehydration as unit operation, the central process and step where the efficiency, where water is effectively removed using selected equipment or methods, depends upon what kind of operation you are performing, what is the purpose of dehydration, and what is the level of dehydration, how much water you actually want to remove from your the raw material to get your product ready for shelf life enhancement or for longer transportation and many others. Then the next is post-treatment additional steps to ensure final product meet the quality standards, including moisture content, and even then it is sent for the packaging. So the next are the dehydration techniques usually used, mass and heat transfer principles. Dehydration mainly use mass and heat transfer principles. The foundation of efficient moisture removal involving the exchange of mass and heat. Basically, when we exchange heat, there is definitely an exchange of mass. So the moisture removal is exchange of mass from product to the environment, or you can even store that moisture using the distillation process. So the understanding phase, equilibria to optimize separation process, that was the thermodynamics of the separation, and the control and automation, as our discussion is about the automation and controls, precise control of temperature and humidity and other variables consistent for is are very important for the consistent results. Then the next use of safety means that is very, very important in every engineering technique. So the safeguard against potential hazards such as high temperature or exposure or volatile chemicals. This is up to much extent is controlled by the automation and use of different techniques or different automation techniques or different equipments on online controls. And the next one, what are the main challenges in the industry of dehydration? The main challenges, the major challenge is in production. So the, in the, my PhD research is also about something like that. So the outcome of my PhD was the reduction in energy consumption, as well keeping the quality at acceptable level or at best level. And the next one is fouling, which is occurs usually. So during the process, as recently we occurred that operation while just dehydrating some onions in the lab. So there was variation in temperature. So just lost many onions. And then one is chromium. So many things that used with water may occur or may encounter chromium. So these are major problems. How engineers tackle these problems or issues? Now engineers are very smart and they are using advanced materials, improved system design to maintain this all energy efficient process. And the major one is the automation. Automation has solved many of our problems. So the next is just a case study about the dehydration process. I am going to introduce dehydration onion production as a case study. So what is this actually? Dehydrated onion production is a specialized agricultural or food processing operation that involves transformation of fresh onion into shelf stable product with a longer shelf life. This case study examines the process of dehydrated onion production, highlighting its significance in the food industry and showcasing the operations of park-based company, Kitchen Alharman. This is a company which I just took as example. So the background of this process is onions are staple ingredients in various cuisines around the world. Basically, even in Pakistan, we are using the onion as basic component in our each and every curry or every soylent, whatever you want. So making all the dishes, the main ingredient is onion, but very unfortunately, it is very, very seasonal crop, and we harvest in one season, that around April and March and April every year. So after that, it just goes to the stores and the people has to buy a very high cost onions. So what this company is doing actually is just converting the onions into dehydrated flakes or dehydrated powder that can last long on the shelf, in the refrigerator or in the freezer, wherever you want, you can just keep it. So in that way, the life shelf life will enhance. So they are now available throughout the year, dehydrated at an acceptable cost. Actually, at production season, the cost is very minimum. And after that, during the late months, the cost is very, very high. Even during last year, it went beyond 400 PKR. That was very, very expensive for the people of Pakistan. So dehydrated onion production addresses the issue by removing moisture while preserving the onion's flavor and nutritional value. Actually, it's to preserve the flavor and nutritional value. For that, engineers have developed some mechanism. So the industry is using the same mechanism. So what are the challenges to the industry? Mainly, challenges seasonal sourcing. Onions are typically harvested during a specified season. Kitchener Harman tackled this challenge by establishing long-term contracts with local farmers for a steady supply throughout the year. The next one is quality control. Maintaining the aroma, taste, and color of dehydrated onions is essential. The company invested in state-of-the-art drying equipment, including low temperature drying methods to ensure the product quality. The efficient processing to minimize waste and optimize production, Kitchen Alarmman implemented automated storing and cutting systems, reducing labor cost and improving the consistency. Product diversity. Recognizing diverse customers need, the company expanded its product line to include organic, low sodium and specialty onion products, requiring adjustments to dehydration process and additional certifications. Packaging and storage is also a very big challenge. The choice of packaging material is crucial to prevent moisture ingress. Although you have already dehydrated the product, but if it is well exposed to the environment, it will regain the moisture and deteriorate fast. So the Kitchener Harman invested in moisture proof packaging and storage facilities to maintain product quality during the storage and distribution. So what are the technologies being used? What are the engineering strategies being employed? So onion dehydration is a complex process that involves several engineering strategies to efficiently remove moisture from onion while preserving the flavor, color, and nutritional value. Below are some of the key engineering strategies employed in onion dehydration. First one is low temperature. That is very important, as I have already told about the preservation of nutrition and taste and aroma. Precise temperature and humidity control. If just varying, it will deteriorate the quality. Airflow design is much important while designing heat recovery system. If we are using such systems, so we can harvest heat again and reuse it. Continuous drying system, pre-drying treatments. Pre-drying treatments in some of the products are very important to maintain their color, aroma, taste. The moisture monitoring and control, that is something about the automation controls. So that is very, very important because we have an issue of power cuts during the day and nights. So during the process, if we undergo something like that, so the monitoring and control system avoids the major damage to the products. Packaging and storage solutions are also important. Quality control and storing is very, very crucial. Energy resources is very big challenge for the world nowadays. Energy, everyone is just worrying about energy. And the waste management is also very important. So engineers can reduce the waste production by producing better engineering strategies and the maintenance and reliability. Reliability on the process or maintenance of the process is very crucial for smooth running of the industry. These engineering strategies collectively contribute to the efficient and sustainable production of dehydrated onions, meeting the demands of food industry while preserving the quality and nutritional value of the final products. So what are the results from this case study? Kitchen Alarm's strategic approach to dehydrated onions has yielded several significant outcomes. Consistently high quality dehydrated onion products, efficient year-round production, and reduced dependency on seasonal fluctuations, expanded product offering to cater the various market segments, enhanced product shelf life, reducing food waste, strengthening relationship with local farming, and increased community involvement, and enhanced farmers' income. Dehydration onion products is vital component of the food industry, addressing challenges related to the onion product preservation and distribution. Kitchen Alarm's successful operations demonstrate the importance of innovation, quality control, and community engagement in the dehydrated onion production process. By overcoming the challenges by diversifying the product line, Kitchen Alarm has become a reputable player in the market, contributing to the industry's growth and sustainability. So what are the future trends? Emerging trends in advanced material and efficient moisture removal. Engineers and researchers are actively developing advanced materials that improve the efficiency of the moisture removal process, such as nanomaterials like zeolite and silica-based materials are being explored for high absorption capacities and selectivity. These materials enhance the performance of adsorption-based dehydration methods, reducing energy consumption and improving the product quality. Integration of renewable energy sources, which is very important in every industry nowadays. The quest for sustainability has led to the integration of renewable energy sources in dehydration process. Solar and wind energy in particular are being harnessed to power drying and distillation units. These resources reduces greenhouse gas emission, decrease operating cost, and aligns dehydration process with clean energy goals. The next one is its sustainability. Green engineering practices are playing a pivotal role in reducing the environmental impact on dehydration process. Process optimization and waste reduction strategies minimize resource consumption. A closed loop system where the process water is reused contribute to the sustainability and reduce water consumption. This is very important actually. If we are just preserving basically the human is needing for water more and more, and we are getting lack of fresh water. So we must use different operations in which we can preserve the evaporated water that I have already done during my PhD research at UPM. The collected water, we felt that it has some properties. So now some of my professor student is working on the potential uses of that water, that collected water from the dehydration of coconut sap to develop coconut sugar. So we collected the water. It can have some potential uses which are being explored, or any researcher in this meeting can connect me if he or she is interested in a research like this. So the closed loop will help a lot Engineers are exploring low-impact chemical methods that reduce fewer byproducts and waste. And the energy efficiency and emission reduction is very, very important. Energy is a bigger problem, and emission have become an even bigger problem. So energy efficiency measures such as heat recovery systems and improved insulation are becoming standards in dehydration facilities. These measures lower energy consumption and associated emissions, making the process more environmentally friendly. Additionally, the development of clean energy resources like hydrogen is being explored as a replacement of traditional fossil fuels. So next one is the conclusion of this presentation. That are something about dehydration is a multi-phase engineering process using various techniques, equipment, and applications that plays a pivotal role in industries such as food processing, pharmaceutical, and petrochemicals. The principles for efficiency and quality. Understanding the principles of dehydration is essential for achieving efficiency and maintaining the product quality. Whether it's removing water from natural gas, preserving pharmaceuticals through freeze drying, or ensuring the shelf life of food products, engineering solutions are at the heart of success. So it's a driving force for innovation. Dehydration continuously drives innovations in materials, equipment, and sustainability practices. Emerging trends such as advanced materials and renewable energy integration are reshaping the landscape of dehydration process. And then sustainability is a key. As we look in the future, sustainability remains a central theme in the dehydration engineering. Green engineering practices, energy efficiency, and adherence to the environmental standards will guide the industry towards a more responsible and eco-friendly process. Then is the collaboration with other industries. Dehydration bridges industries, serving as a common thread in ensuring product quality, reducing waste, and optimization operations. Collaboration between knowledge sharing among the engineers across the essential for driving processes. So the continuous learning and adaptation. Dehydration is an ever-evolving field, requiring engineers to stay informed about the latest techniques and regulations. A commitment to continuous learning and adaptation is a vital for meeting the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead. So, in the nutshell, dehydration is not merely a process, it is a cornerstone of modern engineering. Its diverse applications and enduring importance underscore its significance in achieving efficiency, product quality, and sustainability across a wide range of industry. So that was all from my side. Welcome your questions and comments, and thank you for being a great audience. And I am very thankful to the all management team again for their arranging such a nice talk. And now, thank you. And I hand over to Musa. Thank you. Thank you, Musa.
Thank you, Dr. Tusep. That was an interesting presentation. Okay, we go to the second speaker. We invite Dr. Agung.
Yeah, good morning, but I cannot share the file first.
Is there any problem, Dr. Agung?
Hello, somebody can hear me?
Yes, or yes.
You need to...
Yes, I want to share my file, but this cannot share my file.
Oh, Dr. Tusef, can
okay,
you...
Okay, okay, I have to stop. Sorry. I have to stop sharing. Sorry. Yeah. No, it's done. Thank you.
Thank you, sorry. Dr. Tusef. Okay, Dr. Agung, okay. Can you share your presentation? Yeah, while Dr. Agung prepare for his presentation, I would like to introduce briefly profile of Dr. Agung. Dr. Agung Engineering Engineer Agung Wibowo, MTIPM, is an associate professor in Mechanical Production Research Group in Faculty of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, Bandung Institute of Technology, Bandung, Indonesia. And then he got his doctor engineering degree in Toyohashi University of Technology, Japan in 2009. And he already published a main paper, and one of his published paper is reverse engineering of Warner type drilling machine structure. Okay, Dr. Agung, are you ready?
Again, I cannot share my file.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah, actually we can see your presentation. We can see your PPT, Dr. Agung.
Just a moment, right?
Yeah, we can see your PPT, Dr. Agung.
You can see my PPT?
Yeah, we can see your PPT.
Wait just a moment. Okay, you can see my PPT.
Yeah, we can see my PPT. Okay, Dr. Agung, a minute is yours.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Okay, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Selamat pagi semua. My name is Agung Wibowo. I want to introduce myself again. Yes, my name is Agung Wibowo, Associate Professor in Mechanical and Production Engineering, Faculty of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, Institute of Technology, Bandung. My current position is now Head of Laboratories and Facilities, Faculty of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering. And I have experience teaching in following courses: engineering drawing, mechanical drawing, manufacturing processes, industrial metrology, quality control, dies and mold, machine tools metrology, design and product development, and the final one is the geometrical dimensioning and tolerance. Okay, the topic I convey today may be different from the topic written on the poster or in the event rundown that you read. My topic today is not focused on the precision machinery for food or agricultural machinery, but as a production engineer, I'm more concerned with the precision product or assembly that food processing and agricultural machinery require, and depend heavily on it. food processing machine and agricultural machinery will not function properly if we do not involve precision assembly and integrate them into one complete product. Currently, we still depend on the imported precision product. Don't we try to design or make precision product? A lot of research has been done. Many designs have been produced, but most of this effort end in the production of prototype. It is still rare and very difficult for product development effort to be successful so that the design product can be produced and marketed. So I think there is a missing link in the product development process. So the title of our topic today is the missing link of the precision product development. Currently, many product equipment and the machinery involve and require high precision machine. For example, product and equipment in the field of aerospace, power generator, transportation, agricultural machinery, food processing equipment, and others. The equipment or machinery in the field we are discussing will almost certainly involve precise assembly with precise mechanism. Generally, this assembly will be a critical assembly because it affects the function and or product performance. As we know, a product or assembly is composed of various components with various functions. We can classify this component into standard component, precision component, and accessories component. Standard component can be precise component, but these components are made by special manufacturers. The integrator only need to buy and the component and integrate them. Precision product rely heavily on the precise component and the mechanism. Failure to obtain component with predetermined level of precision and accuracy will reduce or disrupt the functionality of the product being built. In precision product, component accuracy is very important. So the production process must have a sufficient level of precision and accuracy. Precision manufacturing need to be prepared to support the process of making component precisely and accurately. So this is the environment of the precision component production. Like manufacturing process in general, this process requires supporting element. What is special is the character of the process that must accompany the support elements, such as precision metrology, precision machine tools, and others. One thing that is more important is component or product specification that truly state the level of precision of the component to be made. Complete specification that are not ambiguous and confusing. These specifications are, of course, the result of design of the process that has taken into account all possible deviation and determine all necessary anticipation. This is the example of the component drawn with different specification. The component on the left is drawn only dimension specification, but the component on the right is the drawn with dimension and geometric specification. So what is the impact of this difference in specification? All of the drawing is have the same component. So this is the difference. This difference in the specification can have the following impact. Difference in precision level of machine tools that will be used in production process. Then difference in cutting order difference in tools will be used, difference in jig and fixture, difference in manufacturing duration, difference in measuring, different in measuring instrument needed, difference in measuring method. So there are so many impact that might occur just because the difference in the specification. So we can see that product specification will have a long-term impact on the subsequent processes. So this is the current situation of our product development process. First is the process of the developing process, the process of developing precision product and until the prototype is produced and does not continue until production. Precision product or assembly are imported for use in large system. Precision product or assembly are made on a limited basis, relying on the operator skill and adjusting processes when assembling. The manufacturing industry produce precision component, but is not part of domestic product development. There is a missing link in the precision product development process. So let's look at this problem from the general product development perspective. In general, the product development process is shown in these figures, starting from the planning, concept development, embodiment design, detailed design, testing and refinement, production ramp up, and finally, the production. We do not discuss the planning stage up to the design embodiment. Our focus is on detailed design until the production process occurs. This is where the critical difference between product in general and precision product lies. To making things easier and simpler, we differentiate these stages into two major activities, namely design and manufacturing. So we make detail and testing refinement in the one group design and production ramp up and production, we use the term manufacturing. Connecting the design process with the production process is not an easy thing, especially when it comes to product development stages. There must be transition from the design stage to the production process, and production ramp up is needed until full rate production or manufacturing can be met. In many cases, complex and long design process only end in the prototypes. Meanwhile, the manufacturing industry only acts as a supplier and is not an integral part of the product development process. Let's look at the thing that caused the design process not to be easily connected to the production process. Manufacturing capability does not directly mean being able to develop product. The ability to develop product will make the manufacturing industry more sustainable. This image is the transition George, a deadly George that spirits the design process and the manufacturing process. To connect the design process and the manufacturing process in the product development, it is necessary to go through a difficult and winding valley. This illustrates the difficulties and challenges in the connecting the design process and the manufacturing process. The transition from the design of the product to manufacturing, it usually causes management and especially the program and production management staff a great amount of heartburn. The transition has all too frequently been difficult and costly to execute. And the other side, traditionally, the relationship between the design and the manufacturing process occurs through an over-the-wall approach, where there is a we design it and you build it. The designer works on one side of the wall and through this design over the wall where the manufacturing engineer works. Manufacturing engineer will encounter many problems because they do not follow the design process. Okay, now we look in detail in the design process in the stages of product development. At the detailed design stage, several important things are determined, including the type of material. This is related to the material characteristic, then the geometric characteristic consisting of size, geometry, and surface profile. The very important thing that must be done is to determine the tolerance of the geometric characteristic. The tolerance of the geometric characteristic determines the quality of component, which ultimately determine how high product quality will be achieved. By following the principle of concurrent engineering, at the detailed design stage, manufacturing engineers have carried out production planning, determined tool design, assembly method, inspection method to guarantee the quality of the product. And of course, this activity is based on a detailed design process. This concurrently activity is carried out to immediately anticipate difficulties the manufacturing process and immediately prepare for full rate manufacturing process. The detailed design stage produce detailed design, detailed design document. This document must be complete and clear so that it does not create ambiguity that affect the subsequent stages of product development. Complete and clear design documents are very important. International Organization for Standardization publish standard relating to geometrical product specification, which are abbreviated to GPS. The American Society of Mechanical Engineers published the WIV-14 series, including WIV-14.5, that talk about the geometrical dimensioning and tolerancing, or GDT. This is the other figure of the product development. The point of this figure is the product specification. So the process of design resulting the product specification, that and the next process become the reference or the base of the manufacturing activity. So the hub of product specification is very, very important. Now we will show the case. This is the case number one. The case number one, in the design process, the designer is unable to produce product with complete and correct specification. So product specification is incomplete or ambiguous, so there will be multi-interpretation. The product specification will be used by the manufacturing process or by the manufacturing engineer. In this case, the production process can be carried out, but the precision level of process, type of process, and sequence of production process are determined not based on the actual requirement. and the manufacturing process will be resulting the product, but and the next process in inspection, the inspection process can be carried out, but the measurement method, type of measuring device, and measurement sequence are determined not based on actual requirement also. So the finally, the product may not meet the designer expectation. So it begins with the not capable designer to produce the product specification. Then this is the case number two. In the design process, designer can produce complete and correct product specification. The result is product specification with complete and not confusing. Then the manufacturer cannot perfectly read product. So the problem is in the manufacturer. The manufacturer cannot perfectly read product specification. So they ignore complete product specification. The precision level, the precision level of the process, type of the process, and the sequence of production process are determined not based on the actual requirement. Then for the product, inspector cannot understand product specification. Sorry, inspector can understand product specification very well. So they can determine the level of precision, type of tool, and measurement sequence required. Finally, the product may produce or my product are rejected because the manufacturer cannot read the specification very well. And this is the case number three. Design process, the designer can produce complete and correct product specification. No problem with the product specification. The product specification complete and not confusing. Also, the manufacturer can understand product specification very well, so they can determine the level of precision, type of process, and manufacturing process sequence required. But in this case, the inspector cannot perfectly read the product specification. Same cases with the manufacturer at the last case. So the inspector cannot ignore complete product specification, the precision level of the measurement, type of measurement, and sequence of measurement process are determined not based on the actual requirement. So the result is good product may be rejected and bad product may be accepted. Okay, this is the three cases caused by the one element of the product development cannot read the product specification. And this is the ideal case. Of course, the ideal case, all of the element of the product development can read the product specification, especially for the design designer can produce complete and correct production specification. Manufacturer and inspector, they also can read the product specification. In this case, only good product on only good product are accepted. This is the our targets. Okay, so in the end, to reconnect the missing link in this precision product development process, there are things that need to be considered. First, the ability to produce product specification, so that everything produced in the design process that seek to be to meet customer need can be reflected in the product specification. Second, apply the concept of the concurrent engineering so that manufacturing aspect have been considered during the design process and have been included in the product specification, so that the product development process can be carried out shorter and better. Third, The ability of translate production specification into the manufacturing process and inspection process that is capable in realizing product in accordance with the information contained in the specification. So we hope with this activity, we can connect the missing link. Okay, this is the end, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Agung, for your presentation. Okay, for the third speaker, we invite Mr. Bambang Budiono. Hello, Mr. Bambang. Hello, Mr. Bambang. Are you with us? Okay, Mr. Bambang, invite you to presentation about your expertise. You can share your PPT, but before you presentation, refer your presentation, I would like to briefly introduce your profile. So Mr. Bambang is now as a director of some company named PT Wafik Mitra Teknik, and his expertise is like workshop management and then design and of dies and mold and then application of the high speed machining in CNC machine, and then the other one is process reverse engineering. Okay, Mr. Bambang, you can deliver your presentation. 30 minutes is yours. So hello, Mr. Bambang. You can start your presentation.
Okay. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi, Wilujeng Enjing. First of all, let me introduce myself again. My name is Bambang Budiono. I live in Bandung. I'm owner of PT Wafik Mitra Teknik and PT Tisaba Manufaktur Indonesia. And also I am director of PT Polman Didaktik Indonesia. My workshop at Jalan PSM Kiara Condong, Bandung. Our company is specialist for precision part, mold, and dice maker. Okay. Thank you for the precious chance to given to me present about technical process to support precision engineering. Before we talk about technical process to support precision engineering, we start with what is definition of precision engineering. Precision engineering is specialization of manufacturing process with complex product, high level of accuracy, and tight tolerance. Advantage of precision engineering. A solution for manufacturing complex product, releasing high-tech IDs, reduce the level of human error, high possibility to make competitive product in global market, more effective and efficient in production process. This is an example of effective and efficient process by precision engineering. I take this sample from experience in my workshop to make pocketing and material pre-hardened. At manual machine, I need 1 hour to process, and production cost is 60,000 rupiah. But in CNC machining high speed, I need only 5 minutes in process time, and production cost is 34,000 rupiah. So if we using CNC high speed, the cost process is cheaper, and also more precious dimensional result, better visualization, and smoother surface. Supporting element of precision engineering process. Point number one is knowledge. Point number two, technique. Point number three, skill. Point number four, technology. The technical process to support precision engineering can be divided into the following stages. The first step is to design process. Step two is prototyping process. Step three is testing process. And step four is production process. Step one, design. The first step is to design the part of product to the required specification. This involves using CAD software to create a 3D model of the part. The design must take into account the tolerance and other requirements of the application. And now, let me show video of 3D modeling design with CAD software. For modeling 3D, we can also using 3D scanning, or it's called reverse engineering. We create 3D modeling from the existing product. This is in our company. We just scan the product and 3D image automatically on the computer. Next step is prototyping. When the design is complete, a prototype is created to test the design and ensure that it meets the requirements. The prototype can be made using a variety of methods such as CNC machining or 3D printing. This video shows us how to process 3D printing with plastic material.
Welcome to this episode, where we will discuss 3D printers, one of the newest technologies in our Satisfying Machines series. 3D printers are exciting machines with the products they produce, apart from their working principles. Moreover, although it is a technology that can be called new, its varieties are much more than all other machines. Do you think this gigantic Maradona statue produced by 3D printers, which has changed how art is produced for a long time, is just an ordinary product or a piece of art? Considering that the gigantic sculpture was not produced by hand, the subsequent processes may have turned it into a work of art rather than an industrial production.
In currently, the 3D printing technology are able using metal material, as we can see on this video. Next step is testing. The prototype is then tested to ensure that it meets the required specification. This testing may involve measuring the dimension of the part, testing its strength and durability, or simulating its performance in the intended application. And the final step is production. Once the prototype is tested and approved, it can be put into production. As we know, to support precision engineering, we need machine with computer numerical control. But today, CNC machining center have a movement to high speed machining center. And I will explain what is the difference between CNC machining center with high speed CNC machining center. CNC machining center is a machine with an automation system that utilizes computer device to control precision machinery. And what it can do with CNC machining center, we can make a precision part from metal, plastic, wood, and aluminum, and also can make mold and dies. Now, in high-speed CNC machining center, high-speed CNC machining center is machining center with high spindle speed, minimum 12,000 RPM, high feed rates, more rigid machine and rigid spindle, more precisely from traditional CNC, table with linear bearing, and control with high speed machining mode. Advantage high speed CNC machining center over traditional CNC machining center: faster cycle time, very fine surface finish, extended tool life, reduced vibration, and also high accuracy. This is the comparison of traditional and high-speed CNC machining center according to the time process. On the high-speed process, it can reduce manual finish and tryout process. So with high speed machining center, it will be more efficient. Other things that must be considered for better machining result. First point is tooling. Second point is cutting method. Third point is cooling system. Tooling, handling and cleanness. Keep all tooling clean and organized because dirt and burrs can affect concentricity, rigidity, and tool life. Tool holder must be balanced. And tool cutting edge must be centered to the spindle rotation. Tool must be rigid. For optimum process, maximum length is 3 times from diameter. Next step is cutting method. Number one, passing chip out directly to the cutting point to plus out chips. Most of cutting heat is contained in the chip. It means no recutting of chips. Number two, high speed cutting enable the cutting to cut and remove the material before the cutting heat can be transmitted to the workpiece. And the workpiece temperature is kept low, about 300 meter per minute surface cutting speed is enough for cutting and removing the material before heat transfer. No transfer of heat to tool or workpiece. Number three, maximum radial depth of cut is 40% of cutter diameter. Number four is maximum axial depth cut of 5% of cutter diameter. Coolant system. Fluid coolant. Through spindle coolant. And high pressure through spindle coolant. And this is the most effective for high speed machining center. Okay, this is the last part of my presentation. This picture to show fine surface represent the precision engineering process by high speed machining. The surface is smooth. This is a mold of triple clamp for motorcycle. And this short video will see an overview of company with a precision engineering process. This video also concludes my presentation today. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Bambang, for your interesting presentation. Okay, we go to the next speaker. I invite Dr. Slamet Widodo.
Hello.
Hello, Dr. Slamet.
Okay. Can you hear me well?
Yeah, I can hear you well.
Okay,
Dr. Slamet, before you deliver your presentation, let me to introduce your profile briefly. Dr. Muhammad, Dr. Slamet Widodo is got his doctorate degree in Kyoto University, Japan, in environmental science and technology biosensing engineering lab in 2013. And then he also already published a main paper, and one of his published paper is the effect of different hydroponic types and nutrient concentrations on the chemical composition and antioxidant capacity of purochain or pimpinella purochain extract. Okay, Dr. Slamet, 30 minutes is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, the moderator. Very good morning, everyone, and thank you very much for this great opportunity for me. So I'm very pleased today to join this webinar series, and also to share some of our activities in IPB University. Please let me share my presentation. So the committee asked me to share about something about some control system for smart agriculture. So hopefully I can cover this one, but I think maybe not exactly. I will talk about the control system. I think more about something that I really concerned about the how we can apply such a smart agriculture in the field, because there's still a lot of challenges that you want to realize the concept of smart agriculture. So hopefully it still covers some part of this title, I think. So first, I would like to introduce myself a little bit, because in the previous one, I think still some part is still in Bahasa, I think. So my name is Slamet Widodo. So I am a lecturer at the Department of Mechanical and Biosystem Engineering, IPB University. So I graduated from Kyoto University in the laboratory of biosensing engineering. And currently my research interest is about bioinstrumentation, automatic control, and also robotics in agriculture especially. So you can reach me in this email address. Please, if you have something to discuss or ask, please contact me. So this is the outline of my presentation today. So I will talk a little bit about smart agriculture, how the agriculture sector already made some evolution from manual to digital system, and some technology that needed or required to implement such a concept of smart agriculture, and also some challenges that we need to develop some instrumentation or control system, especially to realize the smart agriculture concept. And finally, I will share some part of our research related to the smart agriculture in IPB University. So what we call like a smart agriculture or precision agriculture or precision farming is really booming right now. I think many people or almost all people talk about this one. And this is also quite a big market actually, because based on this data, we know that this is quite a big market for the some technology related to the precision farming. In the global market size is almost $9.5 billion in 2022. This included many applications from yield monitoring, field mapping, crop scouting, with the tracking and forecasting, some irrigation management, and also some on-farm activity management. And we can see here that actually this technology is still quite new, I think, and still we can see that this technology already utilized a lot in the maybe in the North America, but you can see here like the fastest growing market actually is still not the, in Europe or Africa, but this is in the Asia and Australia. So I think that's why recently we can see in many media that precision farming or maybe smart agriculture get high reputation in the media. So that's why I think this is also very good opportunity for us, but also at the same time, it's also still a very big challenge for us to realize such a concept. So if we look back at the how agriculture make some evolution from the manual to the digital one, we can see that basically we start from the very conventional farming system, yeah, this manual, and then in the early 80, we know like some genetically modified organism, and then in 2008, around 2008, I think, after some mechanization and then some advanced technology like a GPS system introduced to the market, and then it's become very booming, especially the term about the precision agriculture, because basically precision agriculture is related to the how we manage the management in the farm based on the spatial data. So because we in the 2008 or maybe earlier, this is some GPS technology already introduced the market, and then we can get the variability of the data in the field, and then we can manage exactly, for example, how much fertilizer need by each plant in each location, and then we can apply such a precision management system in the land. And now, not only about the location, we can get a lot of information from the many sensors that already connected to the some internet system that you call like IoT, and also some data already broadcast, yeah, from our activity, from many sensors used by some maybe researcher. They send the data to the cloud, and then we can get a lot of information. And basically, that information is can be useful or maybe just useless. It depends on how we can use such data to get some insight, to get the better decision when we do some farm management. Okay, so this is the ideal condition, I think. If we get a lot of data and then using such a data insight, and then we can get a more better decision when we do some farming system for cattle or maybe for the some in the field or also other that we need to do some take some decision making, because we have some knowledge and then we can get a better decision. And this is some technology that actually required to implement such a beautiful concept actually. So this is from IT for All. Yeah, this is some maybe some idea that this is a technology that will be needed to implement such a concept, especially like a sensing technology, some software, communicating system, and also the positioning technology, and also telematics or telemetry, and also some hardware and software system, and also data analytics. So that's why I think many university now opening many data analytics study program like in IBB and also other university. And also that another technology like IoT, IoT, robotics, drones, and also the artificial intelligence will be part, important part when we implementing such a smart agriculture system. But as I mentioned before, there's still a lot of challenge that we would like to implement such a system, because basically agriculture system is quite unique, because it is a complex system with a very high variability. The same product maybe it will be various, yeah, in one tree to other tree maybe the characteristic will be different. From one season to another season, I think will be also some different. So that's why we have to manage such a variability very well. So this is another challenge. And also, many process in agriculture is quite complex. So that's why a lot of things we have to measure, we have to monitor, or maybe we need some model, and also we need to control to achieve such optimum condition. And this is quite a challenge that some instrumentation and control system usually required like specific or unique sensing system, because this is maybe not available in the market like the one that used in the industry. For example, in industry, we usually use like some temperature or pressure, or maybe like some proximity sensor to detect some material. But for agriculture, it's quite difficult. For example, this is some picture like this is the oil palm, fresh fruit bunch in the tree. So actually, it's very important for us to detect which one is already ripe, which one is still unripe, and which one already overripe, because it will be determine the optimum condition for the fruit to be harvested. Because if still unripe, this is the oil content is very low. And then if this is already ripe, this is a good, the best time to harvest. But then if this already overripe, then maybe some fruit already loose, and maybe already the free fatty acid content is already very high. And also the quality of oil will be maybe decreased. So that's why determination of the maturity of the oil palm, for example, is very important. But we cannot find such a sensor right in the market. So we need to develop maybe using another sensing technology, and then we make some modification, and then we can develop another new sensing system for this one. And also, sometimes we need to deal with some complex environment. So that's why to make some control system, or for example, the automatic machinery, for smart machinery, we need a different approach, which with one that may be in the industrial environment. For example, for the autonomous car, we can use a GPS or maybe other sensing device, but such a system, maybe we cannot use it in the such a complex environment. Like this one is the oil palm plantation. So this is quite complex, so many leaves, and also this is very difficult for the GPS signal to penetrate to this environment. So this is like I mentioned before, like the industrial cells already established very well, so we can use it directly. But in agriculture, we need to develop that very specific. So this is, I think, the field that might be in the future is also still very challenging, and also a good opportunity for us to develop like many kind of the agricultural sensors. Also like this one, like just to give some idea that the environment in the agriculture is quite different with the one in the industry. For example, in assembly line for the car, for example, we have like many manipulator, many industrial robot for welding or some assembling. But this robot always handle the relatively like a similar material. They just move to the same position. So I think this will be a little bit different with the agriculture. In the agriculture system is quite challenging, because for example, this is one of the field that many people, many researchers working on is about the harvesting robot. So in the harvesting robot, the first task you have to do is to differentiate, to determine which one actually the mature or ripe fruit. Like this one, you can see this is some green tomato, some orange tomato, and some red tomato. So which one actually the ripe tomato, you have to determine. And the second one, you have to locate the position of this tomato, what is the coordinate, and then how I can approach to this fruit to take the fruit to harvest. So this is another task we have to do. So this is why, because this is very complex, sometimes there's many obstacles like leaves or maybe some plant like a trunk, maybe some other obstacle. This is also very difficult to handle. So that's why until now, it's still difficult to find the commercial harvesting robot, because the situation is totally different. So that's why it's totally different thing with the industrial robot that already intensively used in the assembly line, for example. So this is the condition. That's why we need to some special approach when we apply some control system or some robotic system, some or some automated automation system. So next, I will share some idea. Actually, because the like I mentioned before, like a sensing system is quite challenging, and we need it, because like people said, like we can only control what we can measure. So basically, before we come to the control system, of course, the most important thing is we have to develop the sensing system. So that's why this is area is quite interesting. In IPB, we develop many sensing system, especially for the evaluation of the quality of some agriculture product non-destructively, because it's very important to make it non-destructively, because if we make it some destructive measurement, and then it will be some loss for us. So that's why we focus on the development of some sensing system in a non-destructive way. So this is one example I mentioned before, like determining the maturity of the oil palm fruit is very important. So we can know exact time to harvest this one in the optimum condition, so we can get the high oil and also in the high quality. So this is one example. This is one of our PhD student working with some sensing device using some impedance value, I think. I don't know if this one is impedance spectroscopy or just measure some properties of electromagnetic properties of this fruit. This the device is just simple like this one. So they just attach this device and then put to the fruits, and then they take some measurement, and then they can determine about the harvesting time prediction. Was it already 45 days, for example? And also they also can get some classify some level of the maturity. So this is the result. Actually, it's quite good. I'm sorry, this is in Bahasa. This is some result. They can predict the actual harvesting day, and this is the prediction. So the prediction, also the actual one, is quite close. So this means that the system also quite good to be used in the field. Although maybe this is still something we have to improve, because in the field we have to also consider how we apply such system. For example, for the old oil palm tree, because it will be over the time it will be much higher. So this is another challenge. But basically, this system work quite well. Also, we develop another system, because the previous one is another method, and also we can develop another alternative method. For example, this one we use some camera, some machine vision system to estimate the maturity of ripeness of the fruit, oil palm fruit. This one is just example how they conventionally done this one. They do it manually, so they take the image to get the identity of the fruit, and then they will use some long sticks, and then they put the some camera and then take the image, and then they count the fruits manually, how many fruits is mature, how many fruit is still immature, and then they calculate it, and then they do some reporting for this one, and then they manage the harvesting schedule. So that's why we develop another alternative system using some automatic one. So we develop some robotic system, so they can autonomously move between the oil palm tree and then take the image automatically, and also classify the maturity of the fruit automatically also. So for the autonomous navigation, it's very difficult in the oil palm plantation. So that's why we cannot use the GPS. So in this case, we use some lidar. So we detect the tree position, and then we calculate just the centroid of this polygon, and then we just follow. So we just move like a obstacle avoidance, and then we just move between the tree like this one. Maybe like this one. This is just some illustration about this method we propose. So we detect the tree, and then the tree is destroyed, and then we move, and then we take the image for each trees, and then later we can determine the maturity of each fruit in the tree, like this one. So basically, we have two different things we have to do. The first is, for capturing the image of the fruits, we have to make sure that the camera already captured the only in the fruits area. So that's why it's very important to detect the part of the fruit tree, like, oh, this is the trunk, this is the leaf, this one is the fruit area. And then after we make sure that is in the fruit area, and then we take the image, and then after that we do another task to determine the maturity level of the fruit. So we make this a simple manipulator with the 2 degree of freedom. So you can move horizontally and also vertically to get the exact position for the fruit area. So in this case, we developed using some deep learning model. So we use a faster RCNN and also the TensorFlow. And we do like this one. So this is the prototype. So actually it's not a real one. We just make some model. So this is about 80 centimeter by 1 meter dimension. And for the first task, we determine the position, the part of the tree, like this is a trunk, this is the leaf, this is the fruit area. So we take a lot of image of the oil palm tree, and then we do some labeling and then some training, and this is the result. So like this one, they detect using the camera, and then they detect, oh, this one is still the tree. Okay. Sorry, a little bit longer, so we still wait. After this one, the robot will move to the trees that already detected, the nearest tree. Okay. Maybe another tree, or maybe this one. So the first they detect the tree, and then oh, they still, this is the trunk. And then they move, maybe, oh, this is the leaf area, and then the fruit area. After the they detect the fruit area, and then the robot will automatically capture the image, and then it will move to another part. For example, this one, this is the tree, and then this is the fruit area, and then they take the image, and then it will move to another trees. So in one position, it will take like four trees to capture the image, like this one. So this is the fruit area, and then it will take the image. Okay, and the next step after we got the image, and then we make another model to classify the maturity or ripeness of the fruit. Just the same way we take the image, but for this case, because we don't have a much image, and then we take from other manual system, like I presented previously in the previous slide. So like this one, after training, we can get like this one. So it can classify the fruit based on the maturity. Like this is the brondol, it's mean like overripe fruits. The black one is mean like unripe, and the red one is ripe fruit. Okay, I will just skip this one. So this is the result. Actually, still not really good. So the accuracy is like 70 to 80%. So we need to improve, or maybe to add more data set. But basically, this is some proof that the concept is working quite well, but we need to do some more improvement for this. So another thing we do is about the precision fertilizer for the oil palm, because it contribute quite a big proportion for the total cost for the oil palm industry. So that's why it's very important to determine the optimum dosage for the fertilizer. So this is one system that developed by one of our faculty member, Professor Kudang. So it's already commercially available. It's some cooperation with some fertilizer company, and this already implemented in several oil palm plantation. So basically, this one is the PreciPalm, the precision agriculture platform for oil palm. This one is taking the image using some satellite image, and also some they now also so the researcher also working with some drones. So basically, from this image, and then they can do some analysis to determine the status of the nutrient for each plant. Basically, this is for each plant, but for the practical use, this also can be used to determine the dosage for the fertilizer for each block. So maybe in one block, we just make it to make just the same for one block, because this is for the practical use, it will be useful instead of each tree, because it's still challenging to apply the fertilizers for each tree. And we also develop the fertilizer applicator. So this is made by another faculty member in our department, by Dr. Desrial and also Dr. Raditya and other faculty member. So this actually this already designed to work in the plantation area. So this design, because the in the plantation area, the land is not always flat. Sometimes it's some hilly and so on. So we developed a special vehicle for this one, and it's carry the fertilizer applicator, and it's using the variable rate technology. So we can apply the fertilizer with different dosage for each tree actually. So this is the concept actually. So from the satellite, we can get the image and we can do some analysis, and then we can determine the dosage for the fertilizer for each plant actually, for each trees. But we can also do it for the one block. And then we send the dosage like a prescription from the doctor and give to this fertilizer applicator and to give to the each plant. But the problem is like this one. Because if you want to do some precision fertilizer, of course, we cannot do it manually. Of course, for the people, it will be difficult to measure the fertilizer and give it to the each plant. It will be very complicated. But the problem to make it autonomously working in the plantation or farm plantation, we can see this one is a very complex environment. Even we also try to use some, I think one of the most advanced GPS system we got from some company, and we try to use it in oil palm area, but we cannot get the signal very well, especially for the RTK, because if we want to do some autonomous navigation for some robotic system or some this one like a fertilizer applicator, of course we need quite a good accuracy for the position, but in this case we cannot get it. So I think we have to use a different approach. So that's why I mentioned, because the agriculture is quite complex. So that's why we need to do maybe different approach. I think the approach that I presented previously, like we take the trees and then we just move between the plant, it will be the best way we do in the oil palm plantation. And of course, we will use the different sensing system. Maybe you can use some camera or maybe some lidar or maybe laser range finder like this one. So I think it's the best way. But of course, it will be something we have to do, because this will be different. And then we have no global orientation, right? I mean, like the some in our perspective, like in the robot, we don't know the exact position in the global view. So this will be another challenge. So that's why it's still in developing for the system. So we also working with some control system for the greenhouse, not only in the farm machinery, but also some farm facility like a greenhouse and plant factory, because this is also some become some, I think, trends that the people are so very aware how to produce the plant, not only in the field, but also how we can use modern technology to produce a plant in the better way, for example, in the some controlled environment like a greenhouse or a plant factory. And for the greenhouse, of course, it's already very established, especially in the developed country, but we have to know that actually the concept of the greenhouse maybe will be totally different what happened in the developed country and also in the tropical country like in Indonesia. Because in the subtropical country like in Japan or Korea or maybe some European country, because they have a four season. Like, so during the winter, it's very difficult to grow the plant. So that's why they develop like a greenhouse to capture or to save the heat, so they can accumulate the heat inside the greenhouse so they can grow during the winter. But in Indonesia, we have a very high temperature all the time, so it will be different. So for us, for the greenhouse, it's not important to capture the heat, but the most important is how we can keep the temperature as good as possible. So that's why the concept is different, and the control system we apply to such system maybe will also different. So this year we have some project with some Korean consortium to develop a smart greenhouse that may be suitable for the tropical condition. It's just illustration like this one. We now still under constructing the facility, and then later we develop the appropriate control system. And before that, actually, this is some idea I take from the Liao et al. 2017 to give you some idea what actually the precision agriculture or smart agriculture applied in the controlled environment. So this is, I think, can be applied in all commodities, but the concept basically is just the same. So for the plant, actually, what we want is actually we want to produce the high quality plant so we can get the high economic benefit. And to get the high quality plant, of course, we have to control the process. So there is some input, some process, also the output. So that's why it's very important to control, to monitor the input like this one. They develop some IoT system to monitor the environmental condition, like a temperature, humidity, light intensity, maybe CO2 concentration, and so on. And also it's very important to evaluate, to monitor the output. It means like the in the greenhouse or plant factory, it should be the plant itself. So we have to develop some system to evaluate the output. For example, what is the canopy? What is the color of the leaf? What is about the flower? We have to evaluate it. Is it good or not? And then when we accumulate all the data, and then we can do some data mining, so we can get some insight. What is actually the most important parameter we have to control? And then what is the setup, the target, right? The set point for the each parameter, the best one to get the very high quality of the product. So from this analysis, and then we can do the smart control for the greenhouse. And by doing so, and then we can expect that we can produce a high quality product, and then we can get the very good economic benefit from this one. So I think this is the idea. We can do it for all the commodities, I think. So that's why this is one of my PhD student just graduated my last month. So we developed some control system for greenhouse, this tropical greenhouse, because in tropical greenhouse, the main problem is about temperature. So this is just illustration about how we deal with the temperature in the tropical greenhouse. Usually we have some cooling system, like we just use a ventilation. This is an active or a passive ventilation. And also sometimes we do some evaporative cooling using some, maybe some misting system, or maybe using some cooling pad and exhaust fan. And then we can do some cooling system, and then we can control temperature. This is just example. The blue one is like a temperature without the control, and then the orange one, this one is some evaporative cooling. So we just use some cooling pad and exhaust fan. And the gray one, this one is just the same with the orange one, but in this case we also add another cooling system. We have a chiller, so the water we put to the cooling pad a little bit lower temperature, so that's why you can get a lower temperature inside the greenhouse like this one. But when we control the greenhouse, of course we not only consider about the temperature, how the effect to the plant, but also we have to consider about what actually the setup of the sensor of the system to make it affordable or cheaper, as cheap as possible. But the same time, we also have to consider about our condition, especially like in some area like a Bogor. Sometimes the weather is very rapidly changed, after sunny and then the cloudy and then rainy and so on. So we have to deal with such kind of the weather condition. And also we have to consider about the energy use, because in the end, how advanced technology we develop, I think it will be nothing if we cannot give some economic benefit from this one. So that's why we have to also consider about the energy use to make it as lower as possible. So this is an example. So if we have some smart greenhouse facility in our campus, but if we run all the device, I think it will cost like 8 million per month. So it will be very expensive, right? And I think no commodity that is suitable for this condition. So that's why it's very important for us to develop another alternative that can keep the environment still convenient for the plant, but in the same time, we can keep the money. So that's why we developed another system. Like this is some smart system using some neural network and also some genetic algorithm to optimally control the parameter. So we just predict the temperature inside the greenhouse using some parameters. So we do some analysis. We try to find what parameter actually affect the inside temperature inside the greenhouse significantly. And then we use it as the input for our model, so we can predict the temperature. And after that, we can optimize the some parameter. In this case, we just set the speed of the exhaust fan. But of course, in the future, we can also add like we can also control like the the how to say the debit the water flow to the cooling pad, so we can get a better performance. But from this one, we can get a very good model. We can predict very well the temperature inside the greenhouse, and using this model, and then we apply some optimal control system using some tilting algorithm, especially to set the speed of the fan, exhaust fan, so we can keep the temperature as low as possible, but in the same time, we can save the energy. So this is the idea. And this is some optimization in the genetic algorithm, but this is actually the exhaust fan speed, but it's still in hash. Of course, it's some correlation between the frequency and also the speed of the fan. And this is the setup of the system. So we develop our system, and it can periodically it will check the condition and predict, and then they can adjust the speed of the fan and to keep the temperature as the set point. Okay, this is the setup of the experiment, and this is the performance. So this is the condition during the sunny day and also the cloudy day. So you can see that during the sunny day, it can keep the temperature quite low, but still the error is about 2 degrees Celsius. But during the cloudy day, it can save the temperature just 0.5 degrees Celsius. So we can conclude that using such a system, actually, it's very we can keep save the energy, and also in the same time, we can also conclude that the system actually is good for some area that actually the weather is changing rapidly, like in Bogor, for example. This is the weather change very rapidly, and then this adaptive control system, I think, is more suitable, and we can get more benefit in this area. Okay, I think that's all what I can share. Hopefully, it gives you some idea that actually this smart agriculture concept is quite nice. We can try to use the resource efficiently, and also we can try to reduce the effect, the negative effect to the environment, and to make it more sustainable. And also, this is some solution for the problem that we're facing now, like how we can improve the productivity to feed the more people maybe in the future. But at the same time, we have some many challenges, especially the agriculture area, if you want to apply some advanced system like robotics, automation, and so on, because this is still many challenges, like a sensing system, some complex environment. So they have to deal, and so we have to find the best way to deal with such a constraint in the agriculture. And I think one way we have also to consider is about how we start this one to make people would like to adopt this idea. So that's why I presented many about the machinery or some smart system for the oil palm plantation, because in our idea, if we try to introduce this one to the small farmer, I think it will be very difficult because it will not be affordable for them. But if we start with some company, some industry, I think it will be if we can prove that our system can improve the efficiency, productivity, and then they will be willingly to adopt our system. And then if this already some proof, I think the many farmer will, we don't need to talk to them too much talk to them, but I think they will see the proof, and then we can adopt such a concept, I think. So that's all from me. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Slamet, for your interesting presentation. Okay, we go to the question and answer session. So we already have about some question in Q&A column. For the first question, we have question addressed to Dr. Tuse. Hello, Dr. Tuse.
Yes, I'm here.
We have one question for you from Dr. Ahmad.
Actually, I got two questions, and I have already typed the answers.
We have another question from Dr. Okay. Ahmad for you. The question is, one of the classic problem in dehydration is cost of energy. Do you have experience to build low energy cost dehydration system that can be applied to the dehydrated low price agriculture commodities?
Okay, the main issue is about the price of, you can say, the cost of operation. I have already done some work during my PhD on the cost reduction. Actually, I reduced the, okay, so I actually tried my best to reduce the cost of energy while processing the coconut sap into coconut sugar. Actually, in that case, we tried and found a new technique to evaporate that was under pressure, under vacuum and at very, very low temperature. So, and the time of processing time was reduced by 1/4. So what we made is the reduction in processing time, and reduction in processing temperature. This ultimately come up with low use of energy, lower the use of energy in the processing. So that was something about the dehydration at lower temperature, under vacuum, and to lower the processing time. In my experiment, that was just remained 1/4. So currently, I am working on the development of a machine that could be a smaller machine. Hopefully that can be translated into a bigger machine later on, but now working on the machine that can dehydrate at a elevated evaporation rate that will definitely conserve our resources like time, temperature, heat, and energy. So I hope I answered the question.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Musa.
Thank you. I hope it's answered your question, Dr. Ahmad. Okay, we have another question for Dr. Agung. Yeah, for the, I can see so many questions here addressed to Dr. Slamet in Q&A column. You can directly answer the question on the Q&A column, Dr. Slamet, during I give a question to Dr. Agung. Hello, Dr. Agung. Yeah, yeah, we have a question for you from Mr. Sandy in the Q&A column.
Okay. I saw some question about talk about reverse engineering.
Yeah, that's already you reply, but yeah. There is another question that you have not replied.
Another question is about the prototype, yes.
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 And another question is that you have not replied is from Mr. Sandy that, good day, Dr. Agung Wibowo, excellent conversation. How can we know if the design and prototype are ready for production? What kind of mistake can happen during the production process?
Yeah, okay, I try to answer this question. In the stage of prototype, yeah, we also should test the prototype for two matters. First is for the quality. Quality, it's mean the formal of performing and the function of the product. It first, we have to agree and confirm that the function is good. Is it the first test? After that, we have to approve that the prototype should be tested for the readiness for production. Readiness for production means that all of information to make some execution in the production stage should be enough. For example, is the I say in the presentation that tolerance is important. It include the dimension tolerance and geometrical tolerance. So if the information about tolerance is not enough, this is make confusion in the stage of production. So this is should be approved that all information that need for the production is enough. This is the test of the prototype for the number two. Yeah, I think that's all.
Okay, thank you for your answer, Dr. Agung. I hope this answers your question, Dr. Sandy. And we have another question to Mr. Bambang. Hello, Mr. Bambang.
Yes.
Yeah, we have a question for you. The question is from Mr. Yusnan. Based on your presentation, the CNC machine is cheaper than manual machine to manufacture some material. How about the maintenance cost of those two machines if we put it into the production cost? Which one is more economical between manual and CNC machine?
Of course, the maintenance, yes. Maintenance cost, manual machine is more cheaper. But the output in CNC is more much output.
I'm sorry, I cannot hear your voice, Mr. Bambang. Hello, Mr. Bambang. I cannot hear your voice. Can you repeat your answer?
The cost of maintenance, of course, manual machine is more cheaper.
Okay. But the question is, if we put the maintenance cost into the production, the whole production cost of the two machine, manual and CNC machine, which one is the more economical?
Sorry, this one is.
No. Can you hear my voice?
Okay, but. It's not good.
Okay, I repeat the question. So, based on your presentation, is the manual, the CNC machine is more economical than the manual machine, right? To machine the some part. But what if the maintenance cost? If we put the maintenance cost into the production cost, which one is more economical? Okay. From your best experience.
Yeah, if the maintenance to the production, of course, the CNC machine is more better than a manual machine.
Okay, okay. I hope that answer your question, Mr. Yusnan. Okay, we go to another question. It's addressed to Dr. Slamet. It's from Mr. Budi Raharjo from PRTTQ. One of precision technologies in the agricultural sector is the use of laser in land leveling process, laser land leveling. We in South Sumatra have started applying this technology since 2015 on tidal swamp area supported by IRRI, International Rice Research Institute. The problem is that the equipment is quite expensive and there is no local distribution, even though some parts can be modified locally. We really hope we can collaborate to scale up also upgrade. I think it's not question. A question.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay, thank you very much for the. Okay. Yeah, I'm still typing, but it's okay. I can answer maybe directly. Okay. For Pak Budi, I think this is quite true that the laser system is quite expensive. But in your case, because you do the land leveling, I think there is no other choice. You have to use it, I think. Because if should cover the quite a large area, and then it should be strong power laser and so on. And I think it's true that this is quite expensive. But in our case, so basically what we need is we want to make the machinery. Our machinery can be working autonomously in the plantation. So just laser is just some sensor that we can use. For example, in our case, we just use a quite expensive, cheap, I think, low cost laser device. We just buy a 3 million rupiah, I think. But of course, there's some limitation over there. But it worked quite, I think, quite okay. But also, we can also try to use another sensing, using a camera, for example. So we can just use a camera to detect the surroundings condition, and then we can use it for navigation. But about the price, I think it will be relative, actually. For example, in some industry, for inspection, for example, for the quality, people install an IR system, near infrared system. It's also quite expensive. But the system will be used intensively. So they don't need to take the sample and then go to the laboratory. So they can just use an online monitoring system. So in that case, I think if we use the system very intensive, so the total, the cost for each sample, I think it will be cheaper compared to the one we take from the sample and then go to the laboratory. The same thing, I think if we use the laser system, maybe for the investment in the beginning is quite expensive, but if we use it for some operation that intensively use in the field, the cost will be covered. So that's why we start with the oil palm plantation, because the investment is quite big. So if we start with the small farmer, I think it should be no way, I think. So that's why maybe this is quite expensive, but if we can prove that it can improve the productivity, I think the industry will be the most suitable for this one. So that's why we are now focusing in some forestry and also some plantation industry. So this is the reason why we are focusing on this area, not in some crop or maybe some horticulture sector, because I think it's quite difficult. Of course, we are also doing something with them, but we are focusing on some plantation and some forestry. Of course, we can discuss later more about this one, but this is what I think. And I think for your case, maybe if you use it oftenly, I think the cost, I think, will be covered, I think. That's my question. Hopefully, it answered your question.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Slamet. Yeah, we have still about 5 more minutes for Q&A session. I think we still have a question for you, Dr. Slamet.
Okay, there's some question, I think. So,
yeah, it's, okay. I think it's...
So I will try to answer one by one, okay.
Okay, okay.
Okay, from Mr. Muhaimin. So he's also working with the RCNN. So how many images actually necessary to get the high accuracy? So I think there is no rule, actually. So basically that if we get more image, more data we train, of course our model will be much better. So that's why we try to use the more data set to get the higher accuracy. But of course, in the same time, we can also do some method to improve our data. For example, we can do some data augmentation. So we make some artificial data to train, to add more variability to our data. So I think this is another way. So basically, the more data we have, the more accurate we can get from the model. Okay, what else? For updating the model, GPU, and also learn the model. I think quite technically. So I think for Mr. Agustami, I think this is two questions, but I think this is quite technical. But I think, what is this? So I will skip this one first. Maybe Dr. Agustami, we can talk maybe a little bit detail. You can contact me maybe in my email or maybe in my WhatsApp. I think I can share my phone number to the committee. For this one, Mr. Muhammad Iqbal. This is the colleague of my professor here, Professor Kudang. So what will be the output from this robot? And is it able to define the deep learning fruit bunch from the camera? And is this robot already integrated with the satellite image? So what the robot we develop is a little bit different. So the first one is For the case for the pressing pump, like a system developed by Professor Kudang, actually we just try to develop some system that how we make the pressing pump, because the pressing pump, the output is just recommendation for the dosage for each plant. And to apply it in the field, of course, we need some machinery. So that's why in our system, we try to use some, just to make some autonomous navigation for this. We can detect the trees and then we can count, for example, oh, this is the tree number one, number two, number three, and then we can determine the dosage. And based on this one, we can apply the variable rate applicate fertilizer to each plant. So this is the one thing. Another thing is we developed this robot to monitor the maturity of the fruits. So we developed the system. So basically the output is to be like the map of the fruit in the field. For example, oh, this is some, we have some map, for example, this is some tree, and then we can count. Oh, tree numbers one, for example, these two fruit already ripe, one might be unripe, and then we can get the exact value. How many fruit already ripe in the field, and then you can determine like how many worker we will send, how many, for example, transporter we need to collect the fruit, for example. So this for the harvesting management. So this is a totally different thing. And is it integrated with the satellite image? So this is not that case. So our robot is not connected to the satellite. So for the satellite, will be analyzed using pressing pump, Professor Kudang system, and then from the system, the output will be the recommendation, because from the recommendation, we know exactly which plant and how many, how much fertilizer we have to apply. It will be recorded in some file, for example, and then we can just load it, or maybe we can just transfer this data to the robot, and then the robot can have some idea how much fertilizer to give to each plant. So this is the idea. So I think hopefully it's answered the question.
Okay.
What else? What is all I think?
Thank you for your answer. Okay, we finally arrived in our last session. So before I close this international webinar, I would like to read some conclusion. Precision engineering is a specialization of manufacturing process with complex products, high level of accuracy, and high tolerance. Precision engineering is agriculture. In agriculture, machinery is crucial in industry to enhance product quality and ensure process efficiency. Some research is interesting to be done further to develop advance of material that improve the efficiency of moisture removal process, and some research on developing control system in agriculture area. Okay, again, I would like to say thank you so much for our speaker that already shared their experience, for Dr. Muhammad Husef, Dr. Agung, Mr. Bambang, and Dr. Slabet. Thank you so much. And also for the audience, I would like to say thank you for your attendance this webinar. Again, thank you so much. I give it back to you, Ms. Ada.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Muso Andrianto, for leading our discussion, and to our wonderful speakers, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. To honor our speakers, we will have certificate of appreciation that will be given by the director of the Research Center for Appropriate Technology. So please welcome, for the first time, we have Dr. Ahmad Sarifuddin and Dr. Muhammad Tufet Tusef Asgar.
Yeah, okay, thank you so much, Dr. Tusef, that you already participate in this webinar. Hopefully we can have a collaboration in the future, because this is first time we met in this webinar, right? And you are my colleagues of Dr. Fikri. Hopefully we will have another collaboration in the future. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Smith, and thank you, the management team. Hopefully, I am very much interested in collaborating with this. I hope I am working in a field that is very important for everybody, actually. So hopefully, in future, we will have different, and I am also very thankful to Dr. Fikri. He is a very good friend of mine during my PhD studies at Malaysia. So I am very thankful to him for introducing me here. Hopefully in future we will have more collaborations. Thank you very much again, Dr. Akhmat, and the other management team. Thank you very much. I'm very glad to have listened about the wonderful conversations or presentations provided by the other speakers, especially about the CNN and Dr. Widu about the smart agriculture. Actually, these are something that is the future of the world. So without these techniques or developments, I think we can't feed the ever-growing population of the world. So I'm very thankful to the speakers and the management team and Dr. Smith once again. Thank you very much. And very much thank you for this certificate of appreciation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Muhammad Tusef Asgar. Next, we have Dr. Agung Wibowo. Please welcome.
Okay, terima kasih. Thank you so much, Pak Bambang. And we already have so many students from our office. I think they will also join in the your program in the PhD. I hope that you can be their advisor for their PhD. Thank you so much, Pak Bambang. Pak Agung.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much for the certificate, and I hope the our collaboration will be continue. Thank you, Pak Mr. Ahmad.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Agung. Next, we have Mr. Bambang Budiono. Please welcome.
Okay. Terima kasih. Thank you so much, Pak Bambang. Yeah, Pak Bambang. We also send our staff to your company. We will manufacture some parts, I think. And I think we have to invite your staff to teach us how to, you know, operate our machine here. So I think we will have many collaborations in terms of precision engineering. Thank you so much. Terima kasih, Pak Bambang.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bambang Budiono. Next, we have Dr. Slamet Widodo. Please welcome.
Okay, terima kasih. Terima kasih. Thank you so much, Pak Slamet, Pak Widodo. I think actually we are college because I was graduated from IPB too. I graduated from TPG, Pak, TPG. Angkatan 36. So I'm friend of Saiful, yes, Saiful, and many friends of mine from TIP. Thank you so much, Pak Slamet, for joining and giving us so many knowledge in this webinar. Thank you so much, Pak Slamet.
Okay, I also would like to thank you very much for this invitation for me. And also now I think we in the future, I think it's a quite a good opportunity for us to collaborate. And even now, I think I have a lot of good friends in this research center. And even one of, I think, the staff of this research center is now taking the PhD in our department, and I also become one of the committee. So I think it will be a good condition to make a collaboration in the future. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Pak Slamet. Thank you, Pak Slamet.
Thank you, Dr. Slamet Widodo. Ladies and gentlemen, finally, we come to an end of the international webinar on precision engineering in agriculture machineries. We would like to thank you for spending your time with us today and all the active participation. Thank you for our wonderful speakers, moderator, the committee, and last but not least, of course, to our distinguished participants. Finally, we would like to apologize for the inconvenience matters during the program. Thank you and see you in the next webinar. Goodbye.
Oke, okay, thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Pak.
Thank you so much.
National Research and Innovation Agency, a synergy in an orchestra. Established through the Presidential Regulation No. 78 of 2021 about the National Research and Innovation Agency. To enhance science and technology's contribution to the national development and to improve the research and innovation ecosystem in Indonesia. The National Research and Innovation Agency is a government agency that is directly responsible to the President of the Republic of Indonesia. Consists of 7 deputies, supported by 12 research institutes, have 85 research centers, Executive Secretariat, Executive Inspectorate, Center for Data and Information, Center for Technology Services, and Polytechnic Institute of Nuclear Technology Indonesia. Through the three directions, science and technology resources mobilization, providing a favorable research ecosystem, building an economy foundations based on research. The presence of National Research and Innovation Agency is to achieve Indonesia's goals as a developed country in 2045. Also to make Indonesia as a global reference for sciences, bringing advantages on science and technology development, policy making, and societies. National Research and Innovation Agency, a synergy in an orchestra.
For the audience, I would like
established through the Presidential Regulation Number 78 of 2021 about the National Research and Innovation Agency. To enhance science and technology's contribution to the national development and to improve the research and innovation ecosystem in Indonesia. The National Research and Innovation Agency is a government agency that is directly responsible to the President of the Republic of Indonesia. Consists of 7 deputies, supported by 12 research institutes, have 85 research centers, Executive Secretariat, Executive Inspectorate, Center for Data and Information, Center for Technology Services, and Polytechnic Institute of Nuclear Technology Indonesia. Through the three directions, science and technology resources mobilization, providing a favorable research ecosystem, building an economy foundations based on research. The presence of National Research and Innovation Agency is to achieve Indonesia's goals as a developed country in 2045. Also to make Indonesia as a global reference for sciences, bringing advantages on science and technology development, policy making, and societies. National Research and Innovation Agency, a synergy in an orchestra. Established through the Presidential Regulation Number 78 of 2021 about the National Research and Innovation Agency. To enhance science and technology's contribution to the national development and to improve the research and innovation ecosystem in Indonesia. The National Research and Innovation Agency is a government agency that is directly responsible to the President of the Republic of Indonesia. Consists of 7 deputies, supported by 12 research institutes, have 85 research centers, Executive Secretariat, Executive Inspectorate, Center for Data and Information, Center for Technology Services, and Polytechnic Institute of Nuclear Technology Indonesia. Through the three directions, science and technology resources mobilization, providing a favorable research ecosystem, building an economy foundations based on research. The presence of National Research and Innovation Agency is to achieve